Bore da, chroeso eto i'n gwasanaeth wythnos yma. Mae wythnos arall wedi mynd heibio a dyn ni'n gobeithio eich bod chi gyd yn cadw'n iach ac yn saff.
Hi everyone and welcome to this week's contemporary service. It's so good to have you with us. We're almost at the end of January. By the end of today, Sunday, we will have got through the first month, the longest month of this year. And let's hope and pray that there is good news and better things to come as we enter into February together. We've got a great service planned for today for you. We have a wonderful song that involving our boys again doing some more crazy dancing, and Gwilym's going to introduce that in just a short while. We have a great interview with Evie Roberts, but we'll explain more about that later on, and we'll open God's word together. And as we come into worship today, do grab your Bible. If you've not got it with you, press pause and go and grab it. If you've not got a Bible, use your phone, get online, get a Bible app on your phone. And let's turn to Psalm 100 as we come into worship today. I'm going to read in English, Catherine will read in Welsh, and Catherine's just going to explain where the inspiration for this psalm being used today has come from. So Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Gweiddwch yn uchel i'r arglwydd holl bobl y byd, a ddolwch yr arglwydd yn llawen, a dod o'i flaen gan ddathlu. Cyffeswch mae'r arglwydd sydd ddiw, fe ydy'r un am gwnaeth ni, a ni ydy ei bobl e, y defaid mae'n gofalu amdanyn nhw. Ewch drwy'r giatiau gan ddiolch iddo, ac i mewn i'w deml yn ei foli. Rhowch ddiolch iddo, a bendithio'i enw, achos mae'r arglwydd mor dda. Mae ei helioni yn ddiddiwedd, ac mae'n aros yn ffyddlon o un genhedlaeth i'r llall. I was struck by this psalm during the week. I was watching a funeral and Psalm 100 was read in that service. And it's one of those psalms that I've always thought of as simply just a call to worship, a call to sing songs and to be happy. But it struck me that actually it's a challenge for our entire life, our way of living, and just to be joyful about everything, to be thankful, and that even that through these times of hardship at the moment, things aren't easy, it's to try and be positive, to find those glimpses of joy, those times that we can be grateful and thankful for what we do have. And it's that wonderful reminder that God is faithful, that he does care for us. We are his sheep and he looks after us. No matter what we're going through, he cares for us and he loves us.
And it's such an important message. And I know Catherine has been trying to write down positives. She hasn't managed it every day, but trying to write down five positives a day. And in a session I had with a friend just yesterday, we were talking about the need to recognise and to name the positives and those things of joy, to not give credence to the negative, but to allow the positive voice to speak so much louder. So as we recognise those positives and the glory and the joy that we find in God, let us pray before I hand over to Gwilym. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity we have to be together. We want to thank you for technology. Thank you for the way that it has helped us to stay connected in this difficult season. We thank you, Lord, that we have made it through January, Lord, and we're still here and we're still going. Lord, we pray as we worship you today. Lord, as we sing songs of praise, as we open your scriptures, as we hear from Evie, Lord, we will be challenged in our faith, but also encouraged and uplifted and strengthened for all that lies ahead. So, Lord, just make your presence known in our midst, wherever we are, as we watch this today, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Over to Gwilym to introduce our first song.
Father God, thank you for the world that we're doing today and the services that Mummy and Daddy are doing, and we're in them too. Amen. Now we're going to sing Our God is a great big God. Bye.
We really hope you enjoyed that song and Gwilym's debut in performing. He really enjoyed it and he made sure he dressed up smart to do the performance for today. We're now going to have an interview with Evie Roberts. Evie is a personal friend, particularly of Catherine's. Catherine has grown up knowing Evie, but she's local to us here. She lives in Llandudno Junction. She's a busy, busy lady. She's a local town councillor as well as running her own business at the shop called the Emporium, which does arts and crafts and secondhand items. But she's going to talk about that in the video. And we caught up with Evie to see how the pandemic had affected her and her business and how she stays positive. And she has some amazing things to say to encourage us and give us some tools to cope in the season that we're in. Well, it's wonderful to be joined by Evie this morning or this afternoon, whenever you might be watching this. Evie is a busy lady. She runs her own business. She owns the Emporium shop in Junction. She's also a town councillor for Marl Ward in Llandudno Junction as well, and also works for the Carers Trust. So you obviously don't get much time to yourself, Evie, in the midst of everything else. So the first question we've been asking everyone is this, simply, what are you passionate about? What keeps you going and what inspired you to start your own business and to be involved in the council and all that you're doing?
Oh, that's a big question. So I'm passionate about a lot, too many things, actually. Probably jack of all trades is a best title for me. But I like to keep busy. I like to find new things that I'm interested in. I like people. I really like, I'm a very kind of positive person. I enjoy helping people to find things that make them happy, bringing people together. That's always been a good part of what I like to do. And I'm a yes person. Just kind of, you know, I only need one reason to do something and 100 not to. And so kind of that's ended up with, you know, the shop, the council, all sorts of things. Somebody says, this would be great for you, why don't you have a go? And I just say, yeah, sure, yeah, you know, and kind of learn as I go. And I just enjoy everything I do. I try to, you live once, and I try to fulfill my time here, you know. I try to make sure that there's none gone wasted. which does make me a bit tired sometimes, but if you pace yourself, that's a good theory. My mum and dad, self-employed, have been all my life. And so it's kind of, I think, in the blood a little bit. But beyond that, my shop, I've always been creative. I'm dyslexic. So I found the kind of more academic side of things a bit of a struggle. But I've always been happy making. So I thought, right, I'm gonna take that route. And then over the years in North Wales, I noticed a real lack of places to get things that you needed for making. And then I noticed there was a gap where people have lots of things that have a lot of life left in them. And they don't know what to do with them anymore, and it's such a waste just to throw things away. And so my shop is a place where you can kind of come and find things that are upcycled, recycled, ready to be reused. And so yeah, we're kind of trying to save waste a little bit. We're going to save money, and it's just, and it's a real community hub. And my customers are fab, and they're always a joy. You know, I get to see all their children grow up, and I get to meet their new dogs, and I get to see their projects, and they come in for advice as well, which is lovely. And the council's great because I can support that community a little bit more. It's a little bit wider again. So yeah, just about me, but other people as well.
Yeah. So your passion's people, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
And art.
Obviously
mentioning the shop, you just mentioned there meeting up with people, you know, getting to see people's lives and just sharing the joys with people and kind of the difficulties. But obviously so much has changed over the last year, so how have you had to adapt your business and what you do to sort of deal with all of the COVID restrictions?
It's been tough. I think the hardest part has been the kind of closing, opening, closing again. And the kind of initial worry that I've spent sort of 4 years, well, it's five, I think nearly six now, but it was, you know, going on for 5 years, building up relationships with customers and building up that trust that the shop's there to provide what they need. And then it's gone overnight, and I was worried that, and you know, the internet is a hard thing for small businesses as well, because if people go and find what they need elsewhere, you know, you worry that will they come back. But you know, after the first lockdown, it was wonderful to see the support that people, and people coming in saying, "We're so glad you're still here." And it was so nice to hear that message, you know, that people were there and rooting for me, rooting for the business. And it was lovely. So, you know, with all of the extra, you know, hand gel and limit to people in the shop and things like that, it was still nice to get people in. But during the lockdowns, I was, especially the first one where, you know, everything was shut and there was no click and collect and there was no, it was hard to order anything. I delivered quite a few places with orders and things like that. And it was nice to be sometimes the first person that those people had seen in a week or two, you know, and standing at their gate while they shouted from the door, you know, talking and having a little catch up on just normality. It was nice to be able to give that support in that way as well. But yeah, just to try and, I think just being flexible, you know, being not kind of expecting too much of anything, because there's nobody can tell which direction it's going in from week to week, you know, and being able to just say, right, okay, can't do that now, but that's fine, and put it on the back burner, and then just sort of find something else, you know, and not being too strict about it, I think is a good way to cope with the changes.
Yeah, you've mentioned a few things there, haven't you? Just, you know, just taking each day as it comes, not expecting too much of yourself, being flexible. I mean, you strike me as a very, very positive person anyway. But have you done anything particular to keep your spirits up over the last year? Especially with Mark at home and things. And what have you done to stay positive?
Do you know, I am a positive person, but about every 6 weeks I hit the floor. Okay. That seems to be my limit on kind of staying bouncy. And then I have a period of a few days where I just feel really low. And at first I was asking myself, you know, why do you feel so low? Nothing, you know, nothing's going on. Nothing bad's happened. You know, the shop's still okay and whatever. And then I realized that actually the life we're living in is not normal. It's not what we're used to. It's not anything that should be taken lightly. And I think, and then I started to forgive myself for feeling like that. And just kind of ride that wave. And after a few days, it passes. And then I'm fine, then back to normal again. And just, I think knowing that it goes again and learning that it's fine. And it's just a system that your body has to go through. Your mind has to just get there and get over it. Is that helps to be positive at the other side of it, you know, because I think you can't bottle it up forever. You can't just keep pretending that it's all okay, you know, because it isn't. And I miss my friends. I miss my family. I miss my customers. I miss normal. I miss looking forward to things and booking stuff and, you know, all of that everybody else misses as well. And I think that kind of just letting myself have those few days where I'm just, I don't want to get up really, and I don't really want to, you know, do anything or complete my orders. But but you just have to just crack on and kind of do what you can and forgive yourself for what you can't, and then just, you know, get back to it when you're feeling like it's a possibility.
Yeah,
and talk to people. As well, that's the other thing. Thank goodness for Zoom, and thank goodness for WhatsApp, Facebook. You know, for all its positives, is a great way to keep in touch with people, and that's really important. And to reach out to people who you haven't spoke to for a while, because they might be feeling just like you, you know, and not knowing which direction to go in. So
and it's a really important message. Yeah, forgive yourself for the things you can't do. I was in a conference the other day, and one of the speakers at the conference said, whatever slack you've allowed yourself during this season, it's not enough. We're all expecting too much of ourselves, and we need to be kinder to ourselves than we actually being. So important for everyone to hear. Thank you so much, Evie. As we draw this to a close, kind of, how can we be praying for you personally? How can we be praying for your family? How can we pray for your business and other small businesses like you?
Well, I was trying to think about this one, and I was thinking, you know, I'm okay, I'm all right, but I'd like, if possible, for you to pray for my customers and for family and for everybody else's families as well, because at the end of the day, for me to do what I do and love, they have to be okay. So that I would like, if that's okay.
Yeah, and obviously your role with the Carers Trust as well, obviously young carers.
Yes. Yeah, and yeah, that would, it, you know, to, you know, pray that that can carry on and that we can keep supporting people who need us, you know, at the times where it's most important. That would be lovely as well.
Fab, wonderful. Thank you so much for taking the time out to chat.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
We wish you all the best. And when everything's back to normal, everyone needs to come and visit you in the shop. Get all their craft supplies and inspiration.
It would be lovely to see them all.
Yeah. Wonderful. Yes. Take care, Evie.
And I'm on Facebook on my page, and people can contact me anytime. So, yeah.
Great. Thank you so much. We'll see you soon.
Thank Take
you. Care. Bye-bye.
Bye.
I really hope you enjoyed that interview and you were as inspired and as encouraged as we were having listened to that and talked with Evie today. The one thing that really struck me was that small business element, that Evie knows her customers and her first thought was to pray for her customers. Not only because without customers she doesn't have a shop, but because they are personal to her. They are names of people and she knows them and knows their lives. And there are so many other small businesses who are the same, who care so much. And let's pray together that not only would Evie be strengthened, but also all the other small businesses that we know of and love would also have all that they need to keep going in this difficult season for them. Let's pray, Gweddion.
Ie o dad, da ni'n diolch I ti am Evie, da ni'n diolch am yr hyn mae hi wedi rhannu hefo ni heddiw, a da ni'n diolch gymaint o dad am yr agwedd positif sydd ganddi hi. O dad, dwi'n gweddio a bydd hynny'n rhywbeth byddwn ni gyd yn cymryd o'r gwasanaeth heddiw I trio fod yn fwy positif ym mhob peth. Da ni'n gweddio am Evie a bydd ydi yn rhoi nerth iddi hi I barhau hefo'r holl gwaith mae hi'n ei wneud. A gweddion hefyd am teulu hi, y bydd ydy'n gwarchod nhw, yn cadw nhw gyd yn iach ac yn saff, ac ie, bydd ydy jyst yn edrych ar ôl bob un ohonyn nhw. Diolch o dad am cael yr cyfle I clywed ganddi hi, ac I gweddio dros dy hi a'i deulu hefyd. Amen.
Amen. Yeah, Lord, I want to pray particularly for Evie's business. Lord, we thank you for the shop that she's been running for many years now. Lord, we thank you for the way in which she cares for the customers that she serves. Thank you, Lord, that each customer isn't just a name, but Lord, she knows them and knows their lives and their passions and their interests. And Lord, we do pray that you would protect Evie's business. Lord, we pray for all the other small businesses that are like her in our local area and wider. And Lord, in a moment, we just think of those small businesses that would be known to us. And Lord, we pray that you would protect them and those owners that care so much about their industry, Lord, and the people that they serve. And Lord, we pray for financial packages coming from government, Lord, that they would reach the right people and would be what is needed to keep livelihoods afloat. Lord, we also pray for young carers this morning, another element of Evie's life. And Lord, we are conscious so often, Lord, that young carers are often forgotten about. And Lord, we do pray for them in this season of isolation and difficulty, Lord, for those that are housebound and need care. Lord, we pray that you would encourage them, Lord, that you would strengthen them. And Lord, you would help Evie and the Carers Trust to continue to support those that need it most. So Lord, we just lift Evie to you, all that she's involved in, all the small businesses that we know of locally, all those whom are receiving care or giving care. And Lord, we pray that where we cannot make a difference, Lord, that you would step in, make your presence known and keep people strong and positive and encouraged in this season. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're now going to turn to God's word and I'm going to offer a short reflection based on today's passage.
The gospel reading appointed for today in the lectionary, which is the reading plan that Anglican churches follow, is Mark chapter 1 and verses 21 to 28. I want to read those for us now, and then I want to ask a very, very simple yet profound and life-changing question. Mark tells us this, that they went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus went into the synagogue and began to teach. The people were amazed at his teaching because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. Just then a man in their synagogue who was possessed by an impure spirit cried out, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." "Be quiet," said Jesus sternly, "come out of him." The impure spirit shook the man violently and came out of him with a shriek. The people were all so amazed that they asked each other, "What is this? A new teaching? And with authority? He even gives out orders to impure spirits and they obey him." News about him spread quickly over the whole region of Galilee. There's so much wrapped up in those few verses from Mark's gospel, and what I want to recognise, the ability of Jesus to cast out impure spirits, that Jesus is the ultimate authority in all things spiritual. I don't want to focus on the particular healing, the deliverance that Jesus performs in these verses. I want our focus to be on that question. What is this in verse 27? A new teaching and with authority? And then verse 22, before that, the people were amazed at his teaching because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. I want to ask us the question today, when we look at Jesus, what do we see? When we read the Gospels, when we read the stories of Jesus, when we come into church and we encounter church services, what Jesus do we see? It's clear from our Gospel reading from Mark today that people saw somebody who taught with authority. They saw somebody who was set apart as different from anything they had ever seen before. He taught differently. Now, whether that says more about the teachers of the law than it does Jesus remains to be seen. And we don't know what exactly Jesus was teaching in this passage. We're left to guess. But what was clear was he captivated those whom he came into encounter with. So when you look at Jesus, what do you see? Do you see a man of authority? Do you see a man who can do the impossible? Do you see the Son of God that came to die on the cross for your sin and for your deliverance? Now, I've had some, as many of us have over this lockdown, well, the several lockdowns we've been in, had lots and lots of time to think and to reflect. And often I've done too much thinking and too much reflecting, and I've got lost in myself at times, and I've got my head in such a mess of thinking that it's been difficult to find my way out. And I'm not ashamed to admit that in this lockdown and before it, I've been in some very, very dark places, some very difficult places of struggle. And with the help of a friend over the last few weeks, I've been unpacking this question of what I see, not only in my own life, but also in my faith. And I've come to the realization, and some of you may think this is obvious, and some of you may question why I'm in the position I'm in if I've only come to this realization now. I've come to realize that my focus when I look at Jesus has been more about my guilt and my shame and my sin and the need of him to come than it has been about his willingness to come, his love, his grace, his mercy. See, I've come to realize that when I looked to Jesus, when I looked to the cross, I was captivated, yes. But my focus was on the negative. My focus was on the fact that I was a sinner in need of saving. That it was because of me that Jesus went to the cross and suffered and died. And in focusing on that, I've lived a part story. I've lived a part revelation of Jesus and his grace. Yes, Jesus came to earth because of our sinfulness. He came to earth because we needed saving. But he did so willingly. He did so motivated by complete and total, eternal, unconditional love for us as his people. In John chapter 10 and verse 10, it says Jesus came to give guilt and guilt in abundance. No, it doesn't. It says Jesus came to give life and life in abundance, life in all of its fullness. So when you look at Jesus, what do you see? Do you see guilt? Do you see shame? Do you see another reason to hate yourself and to feel as if you're failing because you don't meet the standard that you see in his life? Do you simply see your need of forgiveness? And when you look at Jesus, do you see the great love that motivated him to come to earth? Do you see the great authority and gentleness with which he taught? Do you see the great care with which he encountered people and pastorally cared for people and ministered into people's lives and situations? When you look to the cross, the ultimate culmination of Jesus' ministry, do you see the darkness and the gloom of sin? Or do you see the glorious light of the resurrection. You see, the truth is, Jesus is no longer on the cross. Jesus is resurrected. He is alive. He is risen and he is reigning. When we look to the cross, Jesus does not want us to see guilt and shame. He does not want us to look at the cross and be depressed. He wants us to look at the cross, to look at his ministry and see life and goodness and grace and joy. He wants us to see the one whom has authority, but the one whom gives authority to us as his disciples, that we would go and do likewise. That we would be rooted in that love and that grace and would find the foundation on which to build our lives securely and the foundation in which to minister and to live in the fullness of his intended life. So when you look at Jesus, what do you see? In just a couple of days, we're going to be celebrating Candlemas. In fact, some churches will be celebrating it today on this Sunday. And that's the moment at which we remember Jesus being presented at the temple. And there's that glorious moment where Simeon and Anna recognize Jesus, the baby Jesus, for who he truly is, the Messiah. And as those glorious words in Luke's gospel, where their eyes are opened, where they have finally seen and received the promise God has made that they would see the Messiah. These verses, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Luke chapter 2, verse 28, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. May we too look at Jesus and in response turn and praise God. May we too recognize the peace that Jesus came to bring. May we too recognize that our eyes have seen salvation, eternal security and hope are found in Jesus. May we see the authority that lies within Jesus Christ, that we may have victory over all things, that all will be well. May we see that Jesus is different and set apart from anything we have ever seen or encountered before. And may we see that he is the light that shines in the darkness, a revelation to us and all people, and the one and only person in whom we can glory and give glory to. When you look at Jesus, what do you see? If it is anything but light, love, hope, joy, peace, kindness, care, grace, forgiveness, then you've been sold a lie. This morning, let us come before the one who willingly and lovingly gave his life for us. And let's recognize that that was the one through whom all things were created, in whom all things find their authority. And let us bow our knee and worship him with all that we've got to give, because he alone is worthy of our praise. As we respond to that, as we consider that question together, Catherine is going to lead us in our final song. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. As we look to Jesus, may we see something different to what we have ever seen before. May we be more captivated and more motivated in love. May we find the strength and the hope and the joy that we need, not only to get through this season, but to thrive in this season and to look forward to the hope that is constant in Jesus. So let's respond and sing together. We really hope you've enjoyed the service today and you're leaving encouraged and uplifted and with the strength that you need to face the week that lies ahead. We truly hope and pray that you would meet God face to face in a deeper and more exciting way than you ever have done before. I want to just close out our service with a form of prayer, a blessing, a form of encouragement, but using the lyrics of that song that Katrin has just performed so beautifully for us. So may each one of us look to God and know that we won't ever be overwhelmed.
May we look to God and receive the vision to see things in a different way. May we look to God and know He is our helper and all that we need. May we look to God and receive wisdom to know just what to do and to say. And may each one of us love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And in doing so, may we love others in the same way as He loves us. Amen. Have a great week, and we shall see you same time next week. God bless and see you soon. Bye-bye. Bye.